Q&A with TNA.
Hi, Prana Boosters. So we promised you a part two. So here it is. Let's continue to talk about the importance of emotions, which was the previous podcast, by learning today more about managing emotions. I could actually foresee there being like 65 parts to this type of podcast.
Oh, at least 65.
Yeah, this topic is really big. So today we are calling this part two of the previous podcast, but it's really our topic for today is the importance of managing emotions.
Right. And I know that this topic is very close to your heart, and we will be even sharing some notes from your parenting book, which you are currently writing.
Right.
How's that going?
It's going. You know, people ask me all the time, how come I'm not finished with my book? I've actually been working on this book for a couple years. I would say one of the biggest reasons that I'm not done with it, I probably have a lot of subconscious reasons why it's not done yet. But the truth is that I literally spend every single day managing emotions.
So you're practicing this stuff, implementing it, testing it.
Yes. I'm basically spend 24/7 on this topic. So many times I'm actually just like with our girls and like with you and working on this and figuring this stuff out. And I'm basically researching it so that everybody else doesn't have to. So you guys don't have to spend 25 years like I have spent the last 25 years watching Oprah, you know, Googling, learning about neuroscience, like figuring out all this stuff. This is going to be like the shortened version. So in my book, I'll help people understand all the things that we're learning and experiencing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so let's just quickly summarize what we spoke about last week when we were discussing the importance of emotions. We were talking about seeing some explosive emotions of a couple that was driving and how they were kind of reacting in an unhealthy, very unsafe way.
Right.
Then we were talking about the fact that you don't really teach this anywhere. Like none of us really like take classes or learn about emotions. So emotional intelligence, which is basically literally like as important as breathing, is not taught to any of us. And
I was younger, I didn't think emotions was a thing.
It wasn't a thing. It's never been a thing. It's been something that's hidden and,
right.
You know, kind of like very taboo. And the thing is we also do not want to... we're trying to raise awareness. We're not trying to shame or belittle like other generations. But when you know better, you do better. So we're actually trying to improve and grow and update our phones and update our own personal operating systems, like our minds.
Right.
So we also gently introduced Prana Boost CPR, which is my own version that I came up with of a method for managing emotional emergencies. Like literally, what do you do in that moment?
And I like the whole play on the CPR thing because it really makes the link between taking it seriously, just like you do with the physical pain.
Right. My intention is for people to understand that a child crying, like that we see people, kids crying all the time at like Disneyland or the store, and you see the parent just continue to walk,
right?
Either drag the child by their hand or just continue to push the stroller.
Like, stop this nonsense.
Yeah. It's like, no, just stop. Like, stop everything because nothing is more important than acknowledging that child needs help right now.
Right.
Just as if they fell on the ground and they were bleeding. You need to get them help right now. So the reason I believe that everybody struggles with this is that we were not raised like this. It was never, like you said, a thing to acknowledge these emotions. And the biggest goal was worrying about what people thought. I mean, we worried about what people thought. So the biggest goal was to try to quiet the emotions so nobody would be embarrassed or stressed or
right.
add to the conflict.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so I would like to just insert a quote here. I really like this quote. It says, "You never change things by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete." And essentially, that's the thing. Without judgment, we're just deeming the old model of handling emotions obsolete.
Yeah.
It doesn't work. It's not healthy. It's not in our highest benefit to practice that anymore. So we're coming up with new methods.
Absolutely.
So we all really want to feel good, right? And
right.
Everybody is like, trying to find a way to be happy, right?
Yes.
So part of the reason that we're doing this podcast is because we want to explain that in order to do this, we must learn how to honor our emotions and the emotions of others. Is it okay if I share a quote from my book?
Yes, please.
Okay. So we are not responsible for the reactions and emotions in others. However, we are responsible for how we contribute to and participate in these emotional situations, and most importantly, how we respond to their emotions.
Beautiful.
So what does that mean? What that means is that we all have our own triggers and we all have our own reasons to react the way that we do. So we're not necessarily responsible for how somebody reacts, but we are responsible for caring that they're reacting like that. Something upset them, something triggered them, either from their childhood, their past, something. Like, there is a reason. Everybody has a reason when they're upset, even if we don't agree with them having a reason. And if we judge them and think like, oh, you don't have a reason to be upset, I didn't say anything wrong, or like you get defensive or judgmental.
And this is interesting because this applies to both kids and adults.
It applies to every human being. I mean, every single interaction with other people can ignite emotions in us. And so if we don't know how to properly react or properly handle someone else's emotions, that's why we have conflict.
Right. Okay. So do you want to talk about some of the things we could do to manage our emotions?
Okay. First, how do we do this? How do we manage, even think about managing emotions? First, we must understand that most of us were raised to ignore or quiet any type of negative emotions. Not really happy emotions. I don't think anyone ever punished us for being too happy.
Right. I think happy emotions are probably encouraged.
Right. So you don't get like sent to your room because you're just like so happy.
Right.
Right. But we were raised to ignore quiet.
Although it is suspicious if somebody is always happy, isn't it?
Sometimes. it's
like, what is
because
his
deal? It's kind of rare. We're like, what? Like, he's like extra happy.
Right.
Anyway, so, and many people are often punished for showing negative emotions. Now, there's many, many ways that you could punish people. You don't have to just like send them to their room, but you can ignore them. You can neglect their needs. You can belittle them. You can shame them. You can make fun of them. You can, well, that's probably a long enough list. But anyway, you know, previously we were also never taught to care for our own emotional and mental health, which we now know is just as important as our physical health.
Yes.
So that's why it's so urgent that we all learn this. And that's why we're talking about it today. So in our home, would you agree, our emotional well-being is equally important as our physical well-being?
Yes. I remember when you used to tell me it's just like someone actually fell into the pool.
Okay. Well, let's set that up a little bit. That's not... one of our kids would have a breakdown and, you know, somebody might call that a tantrum, a breakdown, a freak out, and you would get upset and you would react. And
well, I would get triggered and then their upsetness somehow leaked into me and then I felt their upsetness and then I would actually multiply it.
Right. But why did them having emotions make you angry?
Yeah. Just
now think about it.
No, because
why?
I didn't have the awareness of what is happening.
But why did it make you angry? Like, why would you be mad at a child for being upset about something?
It was completely an autopilot.
Okay. So it was a subconscious.
Yes.
Autopilot reaction.
100%.
You don't even know why you were mad.
No idea.
You used to get very mad.
Yeah.
So not to like judge you in any way, but just kind of like to break this down, I believe that, and let me know if this feels good to you, that part of the reason that you would get mad when they would get upset is you didn't like how they were treating me. So
right.
You were
sometimes
upset.
Sometimes I would try to defend you.
Yeah, yeah. So, and I was like, I never asked you to do that because it always made it worse.
Yeah.
I didn't need to be defended. I needed to help them. But I was already really far along to studying this stuff. So I already reacted differently to them where you were not doing this work. So you did not have that skill.
Correct.
Okay. So you and I figured out and agreed that you would not defend me because I didn't need defending against my own child. And you would have my back in a way that would support them. So one of the ways that I used to tell you to create a visual that when they were upset or screaming or crying or freaking out is I would try to have you imagine that they fell in the pool. The reason I needed to do that is because you're very visual and I needed to give you like a visualization of our child being hurt. And I needed you to connect in your head the two situations that like pretend that they fell so that you could help them rather than add to their upset.
The last thing you want to do if somebody falls in the pool is scream at them, why did you do that?
Right.
Can't you swim?
Right. So you kind of needed me to give you that analogy so that you could reframe it and try to see it differently. So in our house, we always have been trying to see things through the eyes of love. So even if somebody's freaking out, how can we see that with love? How can we be there to help them? How can we not take that personally?
Right. Our team member is down.
Right. Now, you know, that's been very hard to do. And I would say, I don't know, maybe I'm like 90, 95% good at that. But I do have my days where everything gets to me. Like, I feel like...
You're human.
Right. But I'm really hard on myself because I try to be 100% with it. But nobody is. Nobody can be. And that's the whole point of having this emotional intelligence, raising our awareness and mindfulness is not to be perfect, but it's to have awareness so that we can do better.
Just have awareness. And then every single time there's a situation, you just get gradually better because it could take, it took me probably 10 years.
Right. And it's really, it's not easy to learn. It's not easy to create these new habits, but it's necessary. And it really does take a lot of work and a big commitment. So what we need everybody to understand is that just like you brush your teeth every single day, we need to check in and care for our emotional health. You know, in some ways, a lot of people are talking about it. We have, you know, the personal growth and self-help industry is huge. You know, people inspiring us to honor our feelings and the feelings of others. But in most homes, our children do not have voices and they do not feel safe expressing their emotions. Actually, I shouldn't just say our children, but many of us, you know, there's many husbands and wives and people at work and at home that do not feel safe expressing their true emotions. And if they did want to express their emotions because they have no practice or skills at it, they would probably do it in a detrimental way that would add a lot of conflict.
Yeah. And it's a chain reaction because, you know, they treat a certain way and then they treat others a certain way. And then it's like next thing you know, the entire society, the entire human race is suffering. And
right. And everybody's just continuing a cycle, which usually includes violence and shame and blame. And it's just very painful.
Right.
And that affects our mental health. And so my life's greatest passion is really to inspire other people to understand that we as parents, first and foremost, have a responsibility, you know, in our homes to model a lifestyle that honors emotions, our emotions, others' emotions, and teach our kids the importance of emotions, like what they are and why we have them and what's the benefit of them. And, you know, just really like a full education of it.
Right.
So what we also need to understand is that emotions are very, very contagious, but they are only contagious if we do not recognize, if we don't have the awareness to recognize them in another and understand what's happening. And to realize that like our child or a loved one really needs our help. So if we don't have that awareness, boom, they can transfer their energy to us. So they get mad, we get mad. Now everybody's mad. Now the dog is barking.
That's a beautiful way to explain it because that's exactly how I felt when I was experiencing being, you know, getting just being completely happy and perfect. And then all of a sudden someone would have a tantrum or an emotion. And then I felt, bam, my entire, you know, feeling would just completely flip and now I'm negative and then I get sucked into their how they feel and then I would lose my, you know, my cool.
Right. And it's especially dangerous for us as empaths because we can take on the energy of others. But more than that, it was not having the understanding that them being upset didn't need to upset you. Yeah. But as a child, you probably weren't honored in any way for your emotions and you probably weren't taught this type of you know,
like
loving.
I said, I don't think it was even the thing.
Right.
Emotions, so it wasn't even part of my vocabulary, really.
Right. Right. But you do remember being told don't cry and boys don't cry and act like a baby or things like that. So we did acknowledge emotions in a negative way, but we never accepted them, witnessed them, embraced them in a loving way. So there was, you know, yeah. Anyway, there was just no emotional education, right?
Right.
Okay, so when we do have that awareness, we can actually remind ourselves in the moment, like I have to do affirmations, I have to like talk to my angels, I have to like literally be inside my head when someone is upset in front of me, and I have to remind myself that I don't have to take on someone else's emotions and I don't have to take their emotions personally. And boy, do they need my help. So I have to like align my energy enough that I can step in. So this is especially important to remember for our kids because they're, you know, their brains are growing. You know, they're literally not capable of managing their emotions on their own. Like they need us. Their brain doesn't even really fully mature until the age of 25.
That's fascinating. Just like they can't reach something or they need help carrying something.
Yeah.
This is kind of the same thing.
Yeah. So I used to tell you, like, you would be like, why are they doing that? Or, you know, and I say, they need our help. Like we have to
help
them.
Right. I used to say, oh, they're trying to trick us.
Right. That's what parents say. They say like, oh, they're manipulating you.
Right.
Well, you know, sometimes they will actually, possibly manipulate a situation to get mm-hmm. their way, but they're not manipulating us. They don't even have the brain power to think of doing that. They're literally crying out for help. So
that's, you know, a big awakening to just realize that.
Right. And like, there's still a lot of people that don't believe that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, would you say that's true for all kids or some kids?
Nothing is true for everyone, but majority, I would say it is true for. Like,
yeah.
You know, and kids also learn. Remember we watched that video, like, of the little boy on Ellen? He was talking to the mom, and he kept going, listen, Linda, listen, listen,
yeah.
listen. And he sounded exactly like what he heard in his house.
Right, he was sponging it up.
Yeah, he was calling her by her first name. He was telling her to be quiet and calm down and, like, you know what I mean? He was telling her to listen. She was telling him to listen. Like, nobody's really listening to anyone,
mm-hmm.
you know? And so really it's just enough. I mean, it's just time to upgrade. And I believe like punishing a child for having an emotion, like punishing a child for saying something mean or something like that is ridiculous. That's like having them go into the other room and change their own diaper. Like they are literally not capable. Like you're supposed to help them. And, you know, I have many articles on this, but I have in my book and in my other, on my blog, I also talk about, you know, respect. And if we are the experts on respect, like meaning we know what's respect and what's not respect, and we're always calling people disrespectful, we should be able to teach it. We should be able to model it, live it, and teach it and show our kids what respect looks like. Instead of how they usually sound, which is what they either heard on what you're letting them watch or how you're letting them interact or how you're speaking to them. It's usually like mirrored back to us,
absolutely.
Unfortunately. Okay, so really I need people to understand that our kids need us to guide them. I mean, they need us to help them and comfort them rather than shame them or blame them or punish them. I have a zero tolerance for punishing someone for having emotions. Even if it takes us extra time, we have to acknowledge their emotions and stop everything we're doing and realize that it's urgent. Like they need our help. Okay. So one of the other things I really want to say is I just kind of want to be vulnerable here. And I want to explain that we have not always gotten it right. There's been many times where, you've gotten mad or I've gotten mad and I usually get mad at you for getting mad. So I had to learn to be just as forgiving with you as I was with the girls. Like, and I think it's also important as we raise our awareness about our own behavior and we can really look at it and love ourselves through it, we will figure out where we get triggered. Like one of my biggest triggers would be you getting mad at them because I would be like, okay, I thought we decided we're not going to get mad at them for having emotions. But then I understood that this was going to take some time to train our brains to react and, to respond a different way. And then the other thing I would get triggered, one of my other triggers was when the girls fight with each other. That was a big trigger for me and sometimes still is, but I'm a lot better now. Okay, so, you know, one of the things that helps me, you know, really shift my mindset is my daily work. And part of it, I listen to Abraham Hicks. That really helps me. And I love how Abraham Hicks says, nothing matters more than how we feel. And they say this because we are only going to have healthy experiences and positive experiences and healthy and positive relationships if we have honored and felt and dealt with our emotions. So it's really true because our emotions can affect every type of interaction that we have, right?
Right.
So most tantrums or outbursts by children or adults are really emotions that have exploded from not being felt or acknowledged. You know, many times, especially if we don't feel safe, we'll kind of hold it all in. And that's when a big explosion happens, is when you literally just can't take it anymore and everything starts spilling out at once. But it's not necessarily that situation that made you that upset. It's the fact that you have all these emotions stored up and now this kind of upset you and you're just going to let all of it spill out. You know, that's why a lot of people say, well, they're overreacting. Well, they're not really overreacting. They're triple reacting.
Right. You're helping me understand that sometimes they get upset, but it's not about the present moment.
Right. And they don't like when I say that because they don't want to think that it's something like deeper. But if they get really, 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 like really upset about ice cream or something like that, it sometimes might be a clue that they're upset about something else.
Right.
And then the kids will say sometimes like, no, we're really upset about this. Mm-hmm. And but you have to know the difference. You know, you have to know, is it like stored emotions? Is it about that? You have to be like a detective.
Yeah. And now I am. And I witnessed it many times that I'll see that something doesn't go their way. And I see a few hours later, they lose it or they have an emotion. And then I, because I'm aware of it, I could tie it to that event.
Right. And another big thing that I learned is that sometimes they really don't want you to fix it. They need to feel those emotions. So I remember one time when Gabby was like really upset, you know, she wanted to bring home her her vegan ice cream that we had. And on accident, I threw it out. Mm-hmm. And there was literally no way that I could fix it. But you came in and she was crying, like screaming. And I just sat with her on the floor, just right there by the door. I just sat down. She fell to the floor and I just sat with her. And she just said, I can't believe you did that. And I felt so bad about myself that I even did it. And it was just literally an accident. I don't even know how it happened. But you came in and you're like, so we'll go get you more ice cream. And it's no big deal, right? And that made her even more mad because she really didn't need it to be fixed. She needed to be allowed to be upset about it.
That's hard to comprehend.
Really hard.
That's really hard.
She needed to really. Why is that? Because you don't want her to cry?
No, because I feel like I'm wired to fix things.
Right.
Or, you know, even in my work, I like to solve things. It's just something my brain is wired to do. So when I feel something, when I see, you know, them going through something like that, right away my mind goes, oh, how can I solve it?
Right. But what you needed to learn, what we learned together, is that the way of solving it is to let them feel it.
Right.
So in order to heal what they're going through, they have to feel it. In order to heal
I'm kind of still learning that
you have
part.
To feel it. They have to be allowed to be upset. Like, as long as I know that they're not like suffering, right? How do I explain it? Like, I don't need to get them an ice pack or, you know what I mean, or a Band-Aid. Like, as long as I know that they're just feeling some emotional pain, I can sit with them through it. I have a harder time with anger, but sadness, I can sit there and let them cry and hold them and, you know, hold the space for them to have that safe place to cry. I remember she was crying. She was hysterical. It was like the worst thing on the planet that ever happened. You were trying to fix it. I was just sitting there and I said to you, just let her cry. She cried for like 10 minutes and she walked away. And I was all like, what the heck was that, right? Mm-hmm. And I like had to recover afterwards, but she left and went to go play. But she was so happy. Like, it didn't even matter anymore. She just wanted to be allowed to be upset that her ice cream got thrown out. And that was like a huge epiphany for me.
That's deep.
Yeah, that's hard to do. So anyway, what were we talking about? We were saying that, like, you know, really, if we're not like connected to our child, if they don't really like trust us, you know, they're not gonna even really sometimes be willing to share their emotions. If we have in the past made fun of them or shown them that we don't care or dismiss their emotions, they're really not gonna trust us to actually show their emotions. So that's an important thing to know. Brene Brown talks about that. You know, being vulnerable with somebody means we feel safe sharing our emotions and deepest thoughts, and we only need to do that with people who have earned the right to hear it. And hopefully parents would be the safe place, but sometimes kids need a counselor or another family member or something like that, or just a good friend, because the parents are not the ones who will actually listen to their emotions without judgment. So I just think it's important for us to know that we're, you know, let kids know that we're on their team and we're here to honor them when they need it most. And it's really not easy to love an angry child, but that is literally when they need us most and they need us to not judge or abandon them, you know? So we all have to literally learn how to manage our emotions.
Right.
So what I think is important to mention is that we can model healthy, nonviolent ways to manage our emotions and nonviolent ways to respond to other people's emotions. I think if we watch TV or stuff like that, we will not understand that it's possible, but we're telling everybody it's possible.
So as we spoke about on our previous podcast episode, while there are some techniques for managing emotional emergencies, there's really no quick fix, right?
No, it's more like a lifestyle change. It's like a complete different way of living, you know. It doesn't help you to take a pill. Now, I just want to mention, I'm not referring to like mental health, like that requires medication, but it doesn't help. There's no magic pill. There's no, you know, we can't drink or do drugs to manage our emotions. I know this is a very like popular method that we see on TV or in movies. This is not a way to handle big emotions. Years ago, I used to watch Grey's Anatomy, and these, you know, surgeons went to Joe's bar after a hard day. Like, that's what you would see them do. They would drink. And I know that that's what a lot of people do. I mean, they even market that to moms. One time when we were in Chicago with my dad, I actually saw at the grocery store a bottle of wine called Mommy's Time Out. So, you know, if this is a way that we are, you know, managing our emotions, it's really just intensifying or pausing our emotions, right?
Or even suppressing it.
Right. It's suppressing it. And it's just like, I mean, you're not feeling them. So you're not healing them. You're not feeling them. You're not, you know, dealing with them. You're just sort of shoving them aside. And they will show up later. They don't go anywhere.
Absolutely.
So really, there's no quick fix. You know, committing to a healthy emotional lifestyle is the best way to increase our ability to manage our emotions. In order to even start contemplating a new emotional lifestyle, we need to kind of understand some basic concepts. That's actually the best way. So we need to raise our awareness and our consciousness about what emotions are and why we have them. We need to be able to talk about them, have open conversations, and understand about why they're important, you know, why we need them, and how to have a healthy relationship that includes emotional freedom, right?
Right.
Which is, I don't know where everybody's going to learn this, but maybe they'll just tune in here, but...
Maybe they'll buy your book.
Right. Okay. And then so next, we also need to create homes and families that are focused on giving kids a voice, allowing them to speak up, even if it sounds negative, listening to them and trying to figure out, you know, what exactly they need. Why are they sounding like that? You know, and we need to focus on handling all of life's challenges through nonviolence. We also need emotional intelligence, partnership, and connection, which builds trust. Between people to be a part of everyone's day at home, at school, and at work. Okay, and next we need to actually learn to change our language. So our internal, like, self-dialogue, like our self-talk, and our external dialogue, like how we speak to others. So this is one of my big things. I do workshops on this, and this is a huge thing in our house. But we talk a lot about mindful language and that it really, really matters what you say. You create with words, just as much as you can love with words, you can harm with words. And they're very, very powerful. So this is one of the most important concepts, is learning how to really shift how we communicate. That's part of a new healthy emotional lifestyle. Okay, so we also need to do the work that would help us shift our mindset to create this new approach that would allow us to respond to emotions rather than react. So we talked about that earlier, where you said you sometimes would just simply react. You didn't even know why you were reacting like that. And then once you calmed down, you're like, gosh, I wonder why I got that upset, right?
Right.
So shifting our mindset, that will help us respond rather than react. When emotions are present. So if we could understand, you know, this is what I teach in my workshops. I always say, like, when our child is yelling at us, right? Is there a way that we can train our brain to see that they need help and not judge them, right? So instead of reacting like, oh my God, they're yelling at us. There's something I write about where I say, instead of asking, why is my child speaking to me this way? Say, why is my child feeling this way? Like, understand if your child is not speaking with love, they're really upset. They're really hurting. They don't want to be mean. They're not a mean person, even if they're saying mean things. They just are saying they have emotions that they can't work through.
Right. They're reacting to their inner feelings that they can't manage or...
Right. And sometimes it's hard to hear. I mean, sometimes it's really like, it's really, really hard to do, especially because we don't really have any examples of seeing people do it or react that way. So we're kind of inventing it here. Okay, next, we need to understand that emotions affect our physical biology. You know, according to Deepak Chopra, emotions raise our heart rate, our blood pressure. They can cause headaches. They can cause, I mean, there's so many effects of negative emotions on our physical bodies.
Oh, it's like you taught me, emotions are energy in motion. Right?
Yes, many spiritual thought leaders teach that emotions are energy in motion moving through us.
That's a really clever thing.
Yeah.
right.
Okay. So we need to understand that emotions are also our internal guidance system. They're like our internal GPS, and we can learn from them. Like, really, we can befriend them and thank them and bless them and accept them as a beautiful gift, because they are here to guide us. They're not here to hurt us. I just also want people to understand that if we are in a situation where there's negative, like really negative emotions, like especially with our kids, we do have to step in and give them boundaries. You know, we have to let them know that there's no violence in our homes, and we're not just going to sit there and let them like throw things. We're going to give them guidance. We're going to tell them, you know, that it's not okay to handle the emotions that way, but it is okay that they're angry. But here's how we're going to handle anger. Like, we have to guide them. We have to give them boundaries. When there is no violence present, there's just, you know, emotions, we can learn to quietly observe, witness, and allow the emotions to flow. And once it does, it exits their bodies. If we don't allow it to exit their bodies, then it gets stored. And then they have all these unfelt emotions.
Or escalates.
Right. It gets stored or escalates or comes out later in another way. And then that actually can also turn into a sickness and pain, but does actually turn into sickness and pain. Okay, so the last thing I want everybody to understand is that after a really heated or upsetting emotional interaction, we all need time to like realign our energy and later reconnect with our loved ones. So we're going to do that in the next podcast episode. We're going to actually talk about reconnecting after emotional breakdown and what that looks like and how you can do it. And we'll also talk about some more techniques for things that you can do to shift your mindset and create this new healthy lifestyle, and a couple more things that you could do in the moment of a heated emotional breakdown or interaction. So on the next podcast episode, we will continue this conversation.
Awesome. All right. So should we wrap this up?
Yes, let's wrap this up. This is the end. You have anything to say?
I don't. I think this is really insightful, and I'm excited to take it to part 3.
So be sure to follow us at pranaboost.com and pranaboostparenting.com. And you can also find us at instagram.com/pranaboost.
Awesome. All right. Until next time.
Bye.
Bye-bye.